This is Joey with Geekadores here at the 2016 Amazing Las Vegas Comic Con. Joining me today is Michael from the CGC. How's it going?
What's up, man? How's it going?
Pretty good. Pretty good conference so far. So, can you explain what the CGC is and what do you do?
We are the world's leading grading company for comic books. We're based out of Sarasota, Florida. We started in 2000. We've graded 3.5 million comic books in that time period, and we're doing very well here in Amazing Vegas.
All right, all right. So can you explain what goes into actually grading a comic book? I mean, I assume it's much more than just how weathered the paper looks or if there are any bends or crinkles in there.
A lot of people, this is a long story, but we'll make it short. A lot of people just want to basically get, either for nostalgia purposes, get their comic books graded and preserved and taken care of and rated and appraised. And some people are fortunate enough to have really, really, really nice comic books that sell for a lot of money. And some people have just stuff they just really care about and they don't really, condition's not really important to them. When you're looking at a comic book to get it graded, obviously you want it to be as clean as possible, especially for newer books. When you look at old books from a long time ago, people aren't fortunate enough to have mint 60s books. Stuff like that ends up on the news, like the action one that sold 2 years ago for like $3.2 million or something dollars. Not everybody has that, though. But a lot of people here, when they come to a show like this at Amazing Shows, they see a lot of good guest lists. So people get involved with wanting to get their comic book signed. And I work with a lot of people who do that. And getting a comic book signed can add value to it, or it could make it more personal, because you get to meet the artist as well.
All right, now, most comic books, when you want to take care of it, you put it in a bag, an acid-free bag with a backing board in there. Now, is that like the bare minimum you should do to take care of comics? And what should you be doing to preserve comics that are noteworthy or might be particularly valuable?
I think bag and board, definitely. Mylar, also the place where you store it. You don't want to have it like in an area where the sun, there's going to be a lot of heat or a lot of humidity. You definitely want to have it in a cool, dry place. Not in a cellar where there's moisture and stuff like that. There's some people that say, hey, I got some great stuff down the cell, and they pull it up and there's just mold. So you definitely want to have it in bag and board, but a cool, dark place is ideal. And I know people who go so far into having a temperature room in their house because they want to make sure that their comics are preserved. Same thing, even when you get them graded. Grading books and keeping them in the plastic doesn't necessarily just preserve it from, it's not impenetrable to light or water. You definitely want to still take care of your graded books and have them in a cool, dark place as well. That's ideal for any paper-related valuable like that.
All right. So then, what do you think is the most valuable book that you have graded or you've come across in your job here at the CGC?
It was the Action One. I was fortunate enough to hold the Action One. And when that sold for 3.2, nobody saw that coming. We knew it was going to be auctioned on eBay in 2014. And when that sale got released, everybody was watching it. And so when the dealer or the company who bought it, when it went for that price, that was just legendary status. That's just, even, I see a lot of Amazing Fantasy 15s come through. I see a lot of them come through the Stan Lee line. Amazing Fantasy 15, the first appearance of Spider-Man, obviously, is a very, very, very expensive book. But the Action One is just, there's so much history tied to that. Plus, being that it's 1939 when the Action One came out, ASM or AF-15 came out in the early 60s, so it's a big, there's like a 30 years difference between those books. When you see an Action One come through, you see a lot of books that are obviously restored or trimmed or replaced staples, but that's the most valuable one. When you see an Action One come through, people usually go, and there's like a little bit of hush in the room when somebody brings one out. I was able to hand carry one once from a show that a guy had it graded in 7.0 restored, I think. Market value for that's like $185,000, but still was very intimidating to hold something that of that value.
Now, do you have to put on a hazmat suit when you handle something like that, or what are we talking about here?
You want to make sure that you don't want food or water within 100 yards of any comic book. No, I think you need to go on a, you want to keep your area as neat as possible. There's people who come up to our booth on a regular basis, and they put their bag down. And they have their soda in their hand and it's dripping with water because it's sweating, and they have their food and they just don't understand. I don't know, they don't understand conditions sometimes. And you have people who are completely immaculate. I had a guy here at rubber gloves yesterday, which I don't know if you need to do that with every single comic book you have, but being safe, making sure if your hands are sweaty, you wipe your hands off before you touch your books. I've seen people talk with their comic books in their hand and spit as landed on the comic book. So you want to be careful with any sort of sweating or spitting or dripping around your comic books at all. I guess the best way is good hygiene as well when holding comic books, but that's a little bit more of the humorous way, but definitely keep your food and water and and children, because sometimes if kids walk up to the booth, they see something, and I'm talking to you, making a sale, and somebody just grabs the book, like, right there. But I think most of the people out there in the industry understand that you need to handle your comic books well.
What are some comic books that you come across that people are convinced is going to be valuable, but really isn't for some reason or other? Like, there are certain titles that people just assume is going to be valuable. Like, I know there are a lot of comic book companies love variant covers.
Yes.
I assume that's a big thing where people think it's worth something, but it really isn't.
The variant thing is very smart marketing. When you want to get a comic book and have it more rare than just a regular comic. They put out an issue of an X-Men 1, and then they say, but this is the J. Scott Campbell variant. This is the Alex Ross variant. Good example right now is the DK3 got launched, and there's the Jim Lee variant, which is like a 1 in 500, which was going for ridiculous money, graded or ungraded. There was a Frank Miller variant in that same run, and those exclusive variants that get so hard to get, and they get very, people, like you could, I think you walk over there, you probably buy, I think the DK3 number one Jim Lee variant is like $400 right now raw, which is more expensive than a regular 70s book not graded. That's just when you see the price point of that. The only thing that happens when you have a lot of variants is something we call the variant bubble, and this gets in the boring part of the conversation, but the variant bubble ends up bursting at a point where 2-3 years later it becomes a fad. It's like Pogs or Beanie Babies. People are like, oh, you remember that variant went for a lot of money? The true value that people, and a lot of older guys know this, is your first appearances of, you know, Hulk 181, Amazing Spider 129. When you have those first appearances of your 70s characters and your 60s characters, value like that's not going to change. It's not going to go down next summer if there's a bad movie. Everybody still thinks Wolverine or the Punisher is cool. But now, with all the number ones that come out, I know Marvel's just, or DC's launching a... the Rebirth. And it's very, very, very smart marketing. A lot of people are going to get excited, and it's going to get people back into the comic book stores and reading again. They need to do that. If it's not the movies that's going to do it, and when they relaunch something, it's going to get enough buzz. And thank God there's enough media out there. There's, you know, with Facebook and with Instagram, people are going to say, oh, I got to get a new number one. The sad thing is people think that book will be what Action One will be in, you know, 30, 40 years, and it's not. But that all goes with scarcity and supply and demand as well.
All right, so then, say you have a comic book, it is valuable, you want to make sure it's properly graded. What's the process they go through through the CGC to do that?
It's not hard. There's certain ways to go about it. You get sign up for your own account right off the bat, and that's easy. You're in control. You can send your own books in on your own. You make sure you pack them well. You get your discount when you sign up. If you go through a dealer, which is also good, dealers can tell you some books aren't worth grading. Dealers can help you get special deals on stuff, which is great to go through CGC dealers. And there's coming up to a show. I like doing the show more than just being on the phone at CGC and telling people to mail books in. If you have people come to a show, you get to talk to people and look at the stuff that they have, explain them how things work. And people like that, seeing people in person. They have that tactile conversation where they're just like, yeah, okay, I like this one. You're right. Maybe I should wait on this one. And they could get stuff signed or hold off on stuff. It's not hard to do it. Most people just want it to be as easy as possible, and they don't want to spend a lot of money. If they spend a lot of money, then it's already getting to their price point. If they're like, hey, I want to sell this book, I don't want to be spending all this money on graded. I think like when people start to get really, really involved with getting graded, I know guys that their full-time job is just grading books. They just that's all they do is they get books graded and they sell, and they can make a living off that, put their kids through college. And there's other guys who do it just to pay for what they make at a con. They'll just be like, hey, you know, I want to go to a convention, I got to spend my tickets to get in, I got to bring my kids there, so they'll sell a few books and they're able to break even, which is also pretty good.
All right, thank you for your time.
Thanks, man. All right, no problem.